Then.
Lord and Lady Chai, pray forgive our intrusion. I am given to understand you were in search of an artist.
Ah, you must be the new,
Goodness me! What an adorable boy! That silken hair, those pearly cheeks, ooh! And you even smell wonderful, like a bed of flowers! I approve of this one, dearest. I am positive he'll paint us the most delightful pictures.
Yes. Well, I mean, as long as he paints better than that talentless wretch we sent packing last week.
Wonderful, wonderful! Welcome to Yulmore.
Alfino, if it please you, my lady. And this is my assistant.
Your assistant? I've heard of folk bringing in family members, but this seems a bit irregular. Aren't you a little young to have a protege?
We are family in all but name, my lord. Though we share no blood, we have stood by each other through life's many challenges, resolved to prevail together or not at all. Of all people, 'tis he who best understands my work. With his unique insight guiding my hand, the art I create is sure to satisfy your expectations. Once the picture has begun, of course, I shall have no need of constant encouragement. And so I wondered, rather than him being in your way, Might it then be permissible for my assistant to explore the city he has so longed to see? Out of gratitude for his priceless contribution to my art, I thought it only fair that I make this humble request on his behalf.
Did you ever hear of such devotion? Of course your assistant must have his wish. He shall be free to roam to his heart's content. Isn't that right, darling?
Yes. Yes, of course, dearest. Quite right.
animals.
That's him. That's Vorthry. He is attended by Sin Eaters. But how does he keep them from attacking?
Mercy! Mercy!
By the 12! Kaishia, what happened to you?
Who are these impudent louts? I do not recall requesting their presence.
Lord Vorthry, what is the meaning of this? Why is this poor man bleeding to death on your floor?
Why? You ask me why? Because criminals must be punished, and this man is guilty of fraud. He came to us, claiming to be a man of business. Yet his subsequent conduct has shown him to be anything but! Europe is a city built on love for one's fellow man. Those who have naught to give and live only to take are a blight upon our society! To atone for this crime, I ordered that he fling himself from the balcony. And he had the temerity to weep. Please, my lord, anything but that! What then is a man of mercy to do, but offer the sinner another way to show his contrition?
Another way? Meaning what exactly?
Sin Eaters are part of Yulmore society, but they must be fed with ether. Living ether. So, I demanded an offering of flesh, carved by his own hand, from his own hide. And still, he could not do as I asked! A wholly unsatisfactory performance!
It is true that Kaishia won his place here by fraud, but his actions were driven only by a desire to share in your paradise. That you would cast him out, I could almost accept. But to humiliate him thus, to demand his very life? Is this truly the way of Yulmor?
Oh, you dim, deluded child. Have you ever paused to consider what it takes to maintain such a paradise in this barren, broken world of ours? The guarantee of safety and stability. The knowledge that if one only abides by the rules, one has naught to fear. I alone can offer these things, for I alone can command the Sin Eaters. And thus am I alone the voice of justice, and any who oppose me, villains to be punished.
And people call this paradise.
You were granted a place in my city for a particular skill. What was it?
Painting.
Oh, an artiste! Then you shall paint a picture for me of Yulmor. If I find your art pleasing, then I may excuse this display of insolence. Gave you permission to tend to that criminal's wounds. I told you to paint me a picture!
What you need is a mirror, not a painting. It will capture the horror I see before me far better than I ever could. Can you walk?
I think so.
Did that little worm just insult me? Their minds! Torment them! Torture them! Then tear out their hearts!
Thank you. Arang. From this parched earth, the nation of Nabarth, Arang, once rose. When I journeyed here, long ago, I spoke with a sun-weathered elder. He told me Arang meant majestic land in the language of his people. And so it might still be, were it not for the Light's unrelenting onslaught.
Thank you. Master Gengen, this is the friend of the Exarch I was telling you about.
Very good, very good. Though friend or no, all are welcome in Mordsook.
Sook is Mordish for city. As things stand, this Sook boasts the largest and busiest marketplace in all Armorang. You'll find ore from the mines here, of course, but all manner of other things too, many of them rare. As I told you before, not many visit Armorang by choice, but Mordsook's a different story. Merchants come from realms around to purchase the relics the Mord dig up.
Aye, that they do, for Mord do not dismiss the spoils of the earth. We clean them and polish them and reveal to the world their true value. That is why they come here, come from far away, come with much money. And so our Sook is always busy, busy, busy. No such thing as a thing no one needs.
You say that every time, Master Gengen. Some sort of family motto, wasn't it? Or perhaps a Mord philosophy, for which we should all be very grateful. Would that everyone was so willing to take in refugees, regardless of race or creed. Now then. If you intend to spend any time here, you'll want to gain the trust of the locals. And there's a little custom all newcomers are expected to observe.
The cracking of the coin purse. You buy one thing from the market. Price can be low or high, just as long as you buy.
As the good Mord says. In fact, the Exarch sent a little something to cover this very expense. A Verbert gold piece, no less. The first I've held in years.
Verbert gold? Real Verbert gold?
Here, newcomer, crack your coin purse with me.
Oh no, you want my good newcomer. I have jars and pots all smooth and shiny.
Over here!
Come and look!
You buy, you buy.
Enough of that! Calm, I say! This one must still journey through the barrens. Nothing bulky, nothing heavy, no pots! Nothing better for the road than a full belly. Spend that piece at Ronron's place, yes? Eat for three before you leave.
Thank you.
Is that...
It can't be.
Just a lesser sin eater. Nothing to write home about. I knew you'd turn up sooner or later, but I had been hoping for sooner. How are you? We've fought them to a standstill then. The Exarch did say that the Empire seemed to have drawn back when he last looked in on the source. But without knowing for sure how fast time was passing there, I couldn't help worrying that a lot might have happened since then. I'm heartily relieved to hear that it hasn't, just as Alphano must have been. As you can imagine, both he and Uriangée were desperate to hear the news from home when I arrived. I haven't actually seen Thancred and Yshtola yet, but they will have heard all the latest developments from the Exarch by now, or should have at least. When I think of how frantic Tataru and the others must be, I want nothing more than to rush back and reassure them. But we still haven't found a way to reverse the summoning. And even if we had, we couldn't just ignore Uriangée's vision. He may use 10 words where one would suffice, and they may often obscure as much as they reveal. But on this matter, he was as clear as day. I do not doubt for one moment that he saw what he claims. Nor how difficult it must have been to speak about them. The 8th Umbral Calamity and your death aren't exactly topics for idle conversation. As much as I might want to go home, I don't want to go home to that. We can't allow the rejoining to happen, which means we have to save the First from the Sin Eaters. That great wall of white is a remnant of the Flood. 100 years ago, the balance in the First tipped decisively in favor of light. From that moment, it rose and swelled with each passing day, and then without warning, it burst forth like water from a broken dam. A colossal wave of pure light, drowning everything in its wake. Only Norvrant was spared. For the most part, living things are composed of ether of various different aspects. But when exposed to such a flood, their etheric harmony is shattered, and their natural form breaks down. Then they either perish, or are warped into mindless abominations. Yes, that's how the Sin Eaters came to be. They were once living creatures, or people, that were caught in the path of the Flood. Once the change is wrought, there is no going back. In that instant, they are gripped by an insatiable appetite for ether and will happily gorge themselves on any living thing within reach. But even that is not the worst of it. The stronger Sin Eaters can plant light in us, like seeds in soil, corrupting our ether and triggering the birth of new monstrosities. They are creatures of base instinct that exist only to feed and to multiply. They feel no pity, know no remorse, and are utterly deaf to reason. Which is why they must be destroyed. Every last one of them. The infirmary is full of the Sin Eaters' victims. left here to spend their final hours waiting for the change to overtake them.